Choosing a name for your child is a huge decision. It's very personal, and with more naming options than ever before, it can be a difficult one. Now, analysing baby names over time also paints a fascinating snapshot of that era. While the builders' generation, who were born before 1945, chose more traditional names like Peter and Paul and John and Jennifer and Karen for their children, in the 1980s, we saw the baby boomer and Gen X parents begin to draw on baby name books for inspiration and trends. Meanwhile, today's parents, who are the Gen Ys, also known as the Millennials, are not only choosing new and different names for their children, but they're parenting a new generation in Generation Alpha. Now, at McCrindle, we have the privilege of gathering the top baby names and compiling the top 100 national list. And we've just released our 2023 baby names report. And there are some interesting naming trends that Gen Y parents are drawing on for their Generation Alpha children. And as I've been involved with this research and report, we're going to mix things up this episode a little bit. And I'm going to hand over the role of host of this episode to Holly Schafe, our fantastic producer. Hello, Holly.
Hello, Ash. Good to be here.
Very excited to have you back. But before I do that, I will keep the host hat on for just a second and welcome Holly. So, Holly, it's not really a welcome, but a welcome back, because we've had you on the podcast before as a guest a few episodes ago about getting in the head of Gen Z. But, you know, I imagine for maybe some of our newer listeners who don't know you, I wonder if you would mind telling our listeners a bit about your role and what you do here at McCrindle.
Absolutely. Thanks, Ash. So my role is an advisory executive here. So I get to work very closely alongside Ash as our director of advisory at McCrindle. And so that looks like managing a lot of our advisory engagements. So we have a speaking team here at McCrindle. If you haven't come across that yet, Ashley being one of them, and a few of the other on our team who are frequently engaged to go out and share keynote sessions or boardroom briefings or workshops, strategic workshops. And so I get the privilege of being able to speak with clients and help them curate the best solutions within that space. And it's such a joy and a privilege to be able to do that and have a lot of fun while doing it. And I also help produce the podcast, which is very fun. And it's great to be able to, get to listen in on so many great insights from our team and guests. And so, it's a joy to be a part of it today with you, Ash.
It's exciting, like you said, because you're often, well, you are literally behind the scenes of every episode we do. Yes. You're listening in, you're always kind of listening. Camera and mic off, but now I'm like, okay, Holly, can you just host this episode for me? And I mean, no doubt you're going to do an amazing job. I'm like, you could probably put me out of a job, to be honest. But okay, so I'm now in a weird move, going to hand the mic of the reins of the podcast over to you, Holly.
Well, it's an honor. It's an honor to host the ultimate host. So I receive it. Thank you, Ash. I'm sure that all of the listeners are going to be very excited to get to hear from you today and get to hear your thoughts. And so let's dive right into that. So the first question we got going on, just to kind of set the scene, I know you'd mentioned we're chatting about baby names today, which is very exciting. Lots of great insights for you to share. To kick us off, though, we're talking about Generation Alpha. And as I'm sure a lot of our listeners know, that's a topic that you're very much within the space of, helped co-authored a book alongside Mark on that generation. And so before we get into the baby names, can you just give us a bit of an overview of who Generation Alpha is and how Mark McCrindle came to naming that generation? Because it's such a fun claim to fame of naming.
Well, exactly, all the rhymes. I think it's such a fun story. I often say, you know, like, it is a random claim to fame, but I mean, like, we'll take it. Like, you know, it's totally fine. So Generation Alpha, we're talking about kids or children or babies who began being born in the year 2010, which means that the oldest of them in 2023 are kind of reaching their teenage years. And we did a podcast episode on this with Mark, as you'll recall, Holly, all about sort of what entering that life stage looks like. And because they'll span 15 years, it means that next year in 2024 will be the final year that we have them kind of being born. And then we'll move to Generation Beta or Beta, however you pronounce it. Wow. So if that sort of naming system continues, that Mark has kind of been the one to usher in, which is really cool. And the story of that is that about, it was before 2010, before Generation Alpha began, being born, Mark was writing one of his previous books called The ABC of XYZ. So it was, of course, as the name illustrates or alludes to, it's about the different generations. And I think it was during that writing of that book that he realized that nobody had given much thought to like who or what was going to come after Gen Z, because there was no natural next letter of the alphabet to assign to them. And so he conducted a study, as we love to do here, and he asked people, he surveyed a sample of the population, and he said, what do you think the next generation should be called? And a lot of people said Generation A, or maybe even something a bit more descriptive like Generation Connected or the iGen or something to allude to the fact that this generation began being born in 2010. That was the same year that the iPad was released and Instagram launched. So they're only ever going to know this really technologically integrated world. And as a generation, that's really going to shape them. But Mark kind of drew on the scientific naming system of moving to the Greek alphabet, and also to signify that this is a new generation, the first one to be entirely born in the 21st century. They're not a return to the old, but the start of something entirely new. So that's why he decided to name them. And I mean, we wrote about so many things in the Generation Alpha book, but one of the quotes we put in there, which kind of has a nice link to baby names, is one that I just thought I'd read out. It says, a name given to a new generation, like a name given to a new baby, is part of their identity, but it is not who they are. What is more important than the name we are given is the name we make for ourselves. Right. So as much as important as baby names are, and as I think understandable as that responsibility is that parents often feel around choosing a name for their child that will carry them through their life and the different seasons they'll walk through, it's also, you know, up to them to sort of make that name for themselves. So it's a little bit about.
Yes. Oh, that's awesome. And even that quote you read off, I feel like that's just a mic drop moment. I mean, don't drop the mic. It's expensive. We'll leave that one. But no, that's fantastic. And thanks for outlining that story. Yeah, it's really, really cool the way that that came to be. And it's so interesting, even from my perspective, the amount I see on the internet, even on social media or different articles, where Generation Alpha and talking about them and their influence and people getting more interested in what they're about and what their traits are is really coming to the light more than I've seen it before. I don't know if, now that they're kind of becoming teenagers and that sort of thing, but it's really, really cool to have that backstory of Mark having named it and of course of all the research that we've been able to do here. And the book is fantastic as well. Plug for that one, as it also is behind you there in the video.
And not so subtle product
not
places.
So subtle. That's awesome. And that's awesome, Ash. And yeah, you're right. And that does segue very nicely into what we're talking about today, which is baby names. And so now for the big reveal, and I'll do a bit of a drum roll. I don't know if it's going to pick up with the mic, but what are the top baby names from the last year, Ash? Tell us. We need to know.
So the highly coveted McCrindle baby names report. And I think what's also interesting about it is that the different births, deaths and marriages of each state in Australia tend to release their data on this at different times. And so we've actually been waiting for one state that shan't be named in particular to release their data. We've kind of been like pestering them. We're like, hey, where's the data? And it's one of the biggest states, so we really can't produce the report, the national report, without their data. Mm-hmm. But some of the other states have kind of already done a little commentary around what the top names are. So we know, you know, over the last few months of 2023, what the names are in the different states. But the national list, according to our research, is number one for the boys' name is Oliver, and the number one girl's name is Charlotte. Now, a couple of insights on those names. Oliver has been the most popular boys' name in Australia for 10 years, for a decade. Wow. That name has been popular. It's the only name in all of the baby names report this year to have over 2,000 babies be born in 2022 with that name. So the number of occurrences of the name Oliver are 2,276. The next most popular name on the boys list is Noah, and there was 1,896 boys born last year named Noah. So, and even the girl's name Charlotte has only, well, not only, but 1,394. So really, a lot of boys named Oliver in 2022, the last year's data. So they're the top names. And Charlotte has been really popular for most of the last few years. Last year was knocked off the top spot by Isla, but now has made her way back up. So she's now number one again. And so I'll just read out the top 10 because it's always really interesting. So the top 10 boys' names are Oliver, Noah, Leo, William, Henry, Jack, Theodore, Hudson, Charlie, and Luca for the top 10. And for the girls, it's Charlotte, Amelia, Isla, Olivia, Mia, Ava, Matilda, Ella, Grace, and Willow. So lots of, you know, fun, beautiful, cute names in there. It's always really interesting to see, and this is just something we've observed from analysing this data and these insights for a few years now, is a lot of the girls' names, even that I just read out, then end in a vowel and are quite short, like Isla, Olivia, Mia, Ava, Ella. And then the boys' names often end in a consonant, like Oliver, you know, William, Jack, a Hudson. And so some of the names there also in the boys end with a vowel, but we see that more with the girls, particularly even in the top 10. So, yeah, some beautiful names there. And they're the top ones for the 2023 report, drawing on the 2022 data from last year.
So exciting. Yeah. And, yeah, you're right. There are so many great names in there. So if any of you listeners are having a child anytime soon, you got a good list there to work off of. But that's really great. And, yeah, it's really cool as well, even seeing the comparison to the years before. And you've been involved so much in these reports throughout the years, and I'm sure have come across your fair share of names across that time. And so in light of that, is there any interesting trends that you've noticed throughout the different years of the reports? Is there anything interesting that you'd like to highlight?
Yeah, there's a few different trends that we've noticed that I'll touch on. I think as well, I mean, next year is going to be really fascinating, or technically maybe the year after, because it's always a bit confusing, because like the 2023 report is drawing on data from the year before, because obviously we haven't lived through all of 2023 yet. So the delay from when the data comes out is there. But because we're almost at the end of Generation Alpha, we can, in a couple of years' time, definitively say these are the top names for this generation. Like, we're close enough now that we can kind of see, and if they've been popular for most of the years that the Gen Alphas have been born, we can say names like Oliver, Charlotte, Olivia, Noah. They're like really popular for this generation. But, you know, officially in a couple of years, we'll have that kind of information. And even it's always interesting to see what names hover around the 100 rank, or in the 90s, because, you know, they come in, they come out. And often even like Charlotte moving around the top 10, that's interesting, but what's greater is even those kind of longer term trends that happen over the course of, say, 10 years, or names that really rise in the ranks. Because, you know, a name might be 99 one year and then out of the top 100, then back at 97. So it's, as much as that is interesting, some of those bigger trends, what we're seeing, are maybe even more interesting. And some of those include, I guess, that the classic names are still popular for baby boys and girls. Right. However, the counter trend to that is we do see some unique spelling and variations, sort of trend. So parents, one on the one side, want to be a bit more classic and timeless. The other side is a bit more unique and different, as I guess they look for ways to make more, traditional names stand out or be a bit more distinctive. We see the shorter names are common for boys as well. And interestingly, the gender neutral names are becoming increasingly popular. Mm. We see more and more gender neutral names kind of, or names appearing on both the girls and the boys list as time goes on, as well as Gen Alpha names being inspired by nature. That kind of botanical theme, particularly for the girls, comes through. And I guess there's sometimes we say, you know, like pop culture names, you know, or popular culture influences baby names, the royals influence baby names. And something that I picked up, I think, when I was authoring the report a couple of years ago that we've seen continue is that names with I, that end in IE and Y sounds are especially in for girls. So names like Daisy, Ellie, Millie, Rosie, Frankie, even that like IE being a bit more of like a nickname as a first name is kind of a take on some more traditional names, and also kind of more vintage names making a comeback. So names like Vincent, Lennox, Connor, Nora, Margot, or Adeline kind of coming back. So in the top 100, as you can imagine, there's lots of different trends going on. There's unique names, but there's traditional names. There's, you know, different sounding names, as well as more of the ones that we come to know and love. So yeah, there are some that kind of stand out to me from the last couple of years.
Yeah, that's so interesting. And it is interesting to see even what you highlighted there, the the mix going on between classic and vintage, because even so much of that is reflective of, you know, taste. What do we kind of, it's such a big decision, naming a child. And it's interesting what you had even highlighted there, the potential influence of pop culture and sort of things, because these decisions aren't just happening within a vacuum. You know, there's a lot that's going on in people's lives in the world that could very much influence the names. And it's even interesting, Ash, we were talking about it before, just on this topic of baby names, that I've even really seen personally as being a Gen Z on TikTok and being on social media, these pages coming up that are specifically dedicated to baby names and to, you know, different aesthetic categories of baby names. So you have what you'd highlighted there, vintage, you know, names for a little girl, and I have some ideas there, or I don't know, more classic. I'm just trying to think different aesthetic sort of categories, more what you had even highlighted, different botanical outdoors sort of things, different, all sorts of different names. And it just kind of even gets me thinking about how much that sort of thing being on TikTok and on social media can also have an influence on people's decisions, you know, moms, as they're potential moms to be, as they're scrolling and they're like, oh, that's a great name, you know, actually I haven't thought about that before, and bringing that in, it's really interesting how those sort of things could potentially very, you know, have an influence on what people are naming. And so I guess even just in that same light, did you have any other thoughts on how pop culture could play a role in influencing the names people have for their children, or yeah, where that kind of fits in?
Yeah, it's such an interesting question. Like, I mean, I feel like we should run a survey about it to get some real kind of quantitative data behind some of these, I guess, commentary or suspicions, even though we've been analyzing it for a long time. But I think, you know, even when I speak to people in my own life around like what inspired you to choose this name, and for some people it's really about the meaning behind a certain name, and they kind of speak that maybe over their child, or they want them to embody that in their future. Then you've got kind of more family names that are popular within families. There could just be that they like the theme or what the name represents, like you said, you know, botanical, outdoorsy, vintage, that's popular at the time. But then also, I guess, popular culture definitely playing a role in that. And even your comments there, Holly, around TikTok, you know, today there's like, even TikTok as a platform, like I'm just shocked about how many videos I actually watch in one sitting. Like, it doesn't feel like I've been on for very long, but then I'm like, oh, I've watched quite a lot, because they're so short and you're scrolling. It's very much so. But in that regard, even like the amount of creators or names, and if you, as you know, the algorithm is hypersensitive, so if you watch one baby name video, you're getting the rest of them unless you really stop watching. But I feel like, especially maybe as young women, it's almost that idea that you're like, well, I'll just save that for when it's relevant in my life stage. I'll lock that away or make a note of that, even though it might not be at the moment that you're in that kind of sphere of thinking of a baby name. So there's all these different influences, but one of the fun ones that, because we do a lot of media commentary on this, the media absolutely like froth off this research. They love it.
Fair enough.
I mean, we've talked about it before, I think, on the podcast. Like, we do so much important research and nothing ever gets as much traction as this baby names
so
report.
So fun.
And so the media always are like, so what pop stars or popular culture influences are, you know, influencing baby name trends? And it was fun for this report. We put in a few names around, and I guess like some of the correlations or references from pop culture. So
fun.
The name Archie, it's ranked number 12. And it could be from, you know, the most recent member of the royal family, from Harry and Meghan. That's also a popular character in the TV show Riverdale. So you think about where we hear that name a lot, and it's in the royal family and it's on TV. Mason at number 31 is Kourtney Kardashian's son. So any big Kardashian fans out there might be going, oh, yep, we know that.
Good and well, yes.
You've got Willow, which is the number 10 most popular girl's name. That could be from Will Smith and Jada Pinkett Smith's daughter's name, I believe. You've got the name Luna, which also has this kind of botanical, atmospheric name.
That's so fun.
It's a Harry Potter character, so we know Harry Potter's very popular among the millennial generation.
Yeah.
You know, the name Charlie is on both the boys' list at number 9 and the girls' list at number 78, and that could be, I mean, maybe this is a bit of a stretch, but Charlie and the Chocolate Factory or Charlie's Angels. Maybe not as like current pop culture. Maybe,
you know what?
Gone,
no, they
gone
both still work
for that one.
Yeah, no, we're running with it. That's great.
And I'll give you one more example. So the name Harry. popular. Number 18 on the boys list. You got Harry Potter, you got Harry Styles,
yeah.
You got lots of Harry, the royal Prince Harry, or formerly Prince Harry. So, you know, I guess it just depends. But I mean, really, we think about these popular artists, musicians, social media influencers, royals, and there's never been as much information or exposure or even access to their lives through social media particularly as there has been. So I feel like, yeah, the multitude and the variety of names that we can draw inspiration from is greater than it's ever been.
Yeah.
And I guess a note on the royals as well is something that we just see every year, like royal names are popular, even, you know, Princess Charlotte, as, you know, Charlotte being the number one name. And if we, one of the previous years of the report, we did make a correlation of all the names in the top 100 that have a link to, I guess, particularly here in Australia, the British royal family. So yeah, there seems to be a lot of inspiration being drawn from the royals as well for, yeah. You know, new Aussie parents.
Yeah, that's so interesting. And thanks for highlighting all those examples as well. It's a lot of fun. It's a lot of fun, but it's also really interesting. Even it kind of gets me thinking as well about, the different generations. I think you briefly highlighted it, but even how I feel like you could validate this much more than I, being a generational expert. so I'd be interested to know your thoughts even. But I feel like, yeah, in past generations, there's so much sentiment that gets held with naming, you know, a child after an aunt or a grandma, or it's a lot of family members, or just someone in the family lineage. And then I think there's a lot of sentiment to that. Even my middle name, which we have the same middle name, Ash, which is a bit fun. My middle name being Nicole is my mom's maiden name, and she wanted to keep that, so she put that as my middle name. And it's just fun things like that. But it is interesting how, even with what you're highlighting with Harry's and the Archie's and all these different things, it would be interesting to kind of know or see if there is, yeah, that more of a trend toward people naming their children based off of figures who aren't necessarily in their families, but who have had such a positive impact on them, you know, in pop culture or in, you know, in more of that general sort of society realm. It'd be, yeah, it's interesting, I guess, if there was at all that transition that kind of went, you know, these are also people who have impacted me. I want to name my children after Harry Styles. You know, sure, why not? You know, it's kind of fun as well. So I don't know. I don't know if you have any thoughts on that. It's just like a side note.
I mean, look, there are some, as I learned in the podcast that we did about, you know, the term stan, there might be some real Harry Styles stans out there who
I'm
are
sure
just
there
like
are.
Devoting so much of their lives, including their, you know, children's names. But I think some people hold a name really deeply, like they really think about what name they choose for their child, and it could be something that's carried on from their family or a bit of an ode to someone who's gone before, who's had a big impact on them. And then I think there's the other side of it, or the other end of the scale, where people are like, I don't really have a particular reason, but I like the name.
Yeah, which is great.
And whether
as well.
It's kind of, yeah, absolutely, that idea that, you know, it could be like not even Harry Styles, but you've just heard the name so much, and you know, you know some nice Harrys or whatever it might be. I mean, I often think about like teachers and how hard it would be to name your child when you know so many kids with different names, and perhaps you might know some, you know, little terrors in, you know, when there's in those years where they're pushing the boundaries, where you're like, okay, don't have a positive association with that name, so can't use that. I don't know.
So
I mean,
true.
I do have a lot of teacher friends who are like, yeah, that name's ruined for me forever.
Yeah,
but also
it.
I guess like exactly strict, you know, strict off. But I think, I mean, it goes the same, like even I think with family members, like you mentioned, sometimes it's like, oh, I love this name, and then people keep it really close to their chest because they don't want someone else in their life to choose that name, because then you go, oh, well, it'd be confusing to have too many of this, you know, name in the family. So even like with your story, with your parents choosing your mum's maiden name for your middle name, like that, the middle name also provides, I think, a really nice outlet for people to create
Absolutely.
A bit of tradition or history, or, you know, pay homage to someone in their family without it being too confusing if you've got too many, you know, Nicoles in the family per se.
Yeah, something like that. No, that's very true. And it is, yeah, it's very, very interesting insights. And I think it's a lot of fun talking about this as well, because it's just, yeah, it's a fun topic. But you'd also even highlighted before, it's something that gains so much traction, even particularly in the media. There's a lot of interest and buzz around baby names, because like you've even been highlighting, parenting, you know, it's such an integral part of even within a family, you know, people put so much importance on what they name their child, and there can be a lot of sentiment behind it. So it's fun, but it's also very interesting to see these trends and what's been going on and what's been happening historically and what's kind of ahead. And so in that, Ash, why do you think that analyzing baby names is an interesting area of social research? Why are we doing it? And it's fun, but yeah, why would you say it's interesting as well?
I mean, I think even the idea of, or the definition of what social research is, that idea of, you know, the study of human behavior. And we're talking about, of course, humans here and human names. And it actually does very interestingly reveal a little bit about, well, a lot actually, about society at that time, even, you know, the idea of a name or someone's name. And again, it was maybe a little bit of a stereotype, but like, I feel like when people learn that my name is Ashley, if they know a bit about baby naming trends, maybe I shouldn't assume that everyone knows about baby naming trends.
Not maybe the general knowledge, but who's to say?
But you might go, oh, like, you know, if you were alive in the 80s or the 90s, you might realize that that was a really popular name at that time, because I know for me, there was a lot of girls called Ashley and it was a really popular name. Another name that was really popular for the millennial generation, which is mine, is Jessica. I think there's this crazy stat that like 1 in 3 girls were named Jessica or something like that. Maybe that seems way too high as I say it out loud now, but something really
don't
high
fact
prevalence.
Check her on that one.
Yeah, that's right. We've got to go back to the 1989 baby names report and check that one. But no, it was just, I mean, the point was of that kind of comment is it was a really popular name. And again, like I knew like 4 or 5 Jessicas in my class. And so it's interesting because even in the psyche of the millennials, I think when we grew up with lots of different kids in our class, some of the people even I know who are having kids now who are millennials are like, well, I don't want to have my child to have a name where they're just 1 of 6 or 7 in their grade with that name. I want them to stand out or be individual. So I think that's where we see a bit more creativity, as well as just new names being created that we didn't know of or hadn't thought of in the past. So it does paint a picture, I guess, of history, and you can kind of an interesting timestamp. And I just find it fascinating, again, because I mean, you know this, we're just talking about the fact that not everyone knows the baby names report exists, but we do it and we know it's one of our biggest kind of most widely accessed reports that we release each year. And I speak to people in my life who are having children or who are naming children or thinking about names, and it's fascinating to like see the statistics like lived out. Like I know so many of my friends who've named their children one of the most top 10 most popular names, and they didn't even know they were popular. They're like, oh, I chose Oliver or I chose Charlotte thinking it was unique. But like so many people in that time were thinking that,
we're
and
thinking
so they all
the same
chose
thing.
It.
Oh,
we're thinking the same thing. So it's interesting to see that, and that leads us, I guess, down the path of, well, what's influencing this cohort of people having children at the same time to draw on particular names. So I think that's absolutely where we like to kind of draw correlations and see themes. And I think it's, you know, it's like the generations content. Whenever I'm at a conference and I start talking about the generations, everyone kind of like sits up or they lean in, because you can always relate to it. You can always go, well, which generation do I fit in? Or where are my kids? Do I agree with this? You know, these characteristics that you're telling me about my own generation. I think names are similar because we all have a name. Everyone loves the sound of their own name. You're always like, where's my name in the list? Like every time we do an interview, the interviewer is always like, and where's my name? You know, and you're like, well, and I always, every time I do a media interview, I have to like look up their name before the interview starts. So I know, because they're always going to ask that question. So it's such a general interest piece. And like we shared, you know, especially for a generation, like let's talk about the Gen Zs and even the younger millennials who haven't had kids yet, but who might want to one day. There's always this kind of mental list of potential names. Sometimes people have it written in their phone. So people are always wondering kind of and thinking about that if they do want to have kids, because they'll have to cross that bridge at some point around choosing a name. And I think I shared this on the podcast once before, but because we are well known for this report and my name is on a few of the articles that we've written about it, this is a couple of years ago now, someone reached out to me directly, and it was a mum and she was expecting her baby, and she said the baby was due in the next like couple of weeks. So she was right close to the birth. And she was like, I just need to know how many occurrences this name has. I can't recall the name it was. It could have been like Hazel or something like that. And she was like, I just don't want to name my baby this if it's got lots of occurrences in Australia from the year before.
Needs to be
and
different. She was,
and I could like feel the stress of this poor like expectant mum. And she was like, I'll pay you if I need to like find out the number of occurrences. And I was like, it's okay. Like I can let you know. And I was trying to like this weird like crossover from like professional into personal. I mean, I don't know this person, but I kind of tried to reassure her like, I was like, and just if you love, because it sounded like she really loved that name, but she didn't want to choose it if it was really popular. And
yeah,
I was like,
fair enough.
Trying to like get her to back herself. I was like, even if you love it, like, and it is popular, if you love it, does it really matter?
Yeah,
like, I was like, up to you, of course, your choice. But I was trying to give her some reassurance around that. So it is, it means a lot to people to kind of, and for some people, there's a lot of pressure. And maybe those of us like me who are a bit indecisive, you know, it can be hard. I don't have a going list because I'm like, I like them all, you know, they all sound so nice. So anyway, it's an interesting area of social research is what I'm trying to say.
No, and that was great. And thanks for all the thoughts there. Yeah, it's so interesting even what you're saying, because it is so true that, you know, obviously the parents are placing importance on it, but it's also personal for that person who receives that name, you know. Even growing up, I remember you go into a souvenir shop and you see all the names on the magnets and you're looking for yours. Where's my name? Or on a mug. Or I don't know if this is a universal experience, but in school, looking up what your name means on Urban Dictionary. I don't know if that was, same sort of thing where, and it's just funny because, I mean, I don't know where they're getting that. Whoever's filling in those Urban Dictionary definitions, I don't know where they're getting this information from. But it's funny because you click on that and you're like, oh, yeah, I can resonate with some of that. But it's funny because it's just silly. But then you think about it and even what you highlighted with the generations and how there is something that everyone can relate to. It just feels great to be able to relate and have, you know, that sort of unity with people who have the same name as you. It's just, it's quite a special human bonding thing that is, that's funny. I guess we don't think about it too much in our daily lives, but it's interesting to be able to reflect on it when research like this comes about. And I get to have fun while doing it because it is such a fun topic. But as we kind of wrap up some of the last thoughts here, Ash, I know you had chatted before, of course, about what's been happening historically. What are the trends, you know, looking throughout the years as you've been involved and had your hand in the research across the years here? But are there any trends that you think will be on the rise in the future when it comes to baby names that you want to leave our audience with today?
Yeah, I think, you know, some of those trends that I mentioned earlier, I think the IE ending for particularly girls like Sadie and Millie and Hallie, like I've really seen a bit of a rise in the ranks of the data, but also, you know, I feel like I just hear those names a bit more, which I feel like is a bit of a new trend for among sort of these alpha children. And also I guess those shorter names for boys, you know, like Jack, Max, Kai, Finn, Bo, that kind of one syllable, really short and sharp, is something that we're kind of seeing a bit more of. But also in the report, like I mentioned, it's interesting to see what names have kind of entered the top 100. And one of the interesting ones that has entered, I think, is the name Margot for girls. So it's also interesting to see what name they kind of debut at. So in terms of rank rises, that was one of the biggest rank rise names. So it rose 31 spots in the top 100, the name Margot, and the name Reuben for boys as well. So we start to see some names kind of really growing in prominence over the last couple of years. Some of the other ones are names like Thea for girls and Maeve, as well as Remy for boys and Theo, that shortened version of Theodore, which is in the top 10. So I think there are a couple of the names to watch over the last couple of years, but even over, I guess, like the decade, some of the names that have encountered the largest increase are names for boys like Luca, Leo, Hugo, George, and Hudson. They've been quite popular names that have really risen up the ranks, and, you know, Leo and Hudson there being in the top 10. And then for girls, it's names like Daisy has grown quite a lot. Maeve, again, has grown a lot. Even the name Pippa and Aurora as well. So I think we see a few different themes there going on, like that kind of Aurora is a little bit of kind of a nature, botanic kind of atmospheric name. Yeah. Even, you know, Maeve is a very popular character, I think, on the popular show Sex Education, which is big among kind of Gen Z and Millennials. Yeah. And it's interesting, even now, like the oldest Gen Zs are in their late 20s. So even the Gen Zs now are starting to bear children, even though the majority are, I guess, the Millennials. So some interesting names there, but even like different names to or shorten names to more common names. So Sophia is an interesting one, and we see like S-O-P-H-I-A and S-O-F-I-A, so different spellings of the same name, Amelia and Emilia, and even Holly and Hallie, so we see some iterations of names, you know, parents trying to get a little bit creative that with names that have a bit more of like a traditional legacy, bit more common name. So there are a few trends I think to watch, and also the gender neutral I think will be interesting, because we do see across the top 100 for both boys and girls that gender neutral names are becoming increasingly popular. So names like Charlie, Riley, Jordan, Jesse, Casey, Morgan, Jamie and Taylor are kind of all spread throughout the list, and I think that is a particular kind of millennial naming trend that we're going to see, because in the past we haven't seen as many names kind of be on both lists, whereas now we are seeing more of that. So a few trends to watch in the years to come.
That's fascinating, Ash. Thank you for sharing your wisdom and your insights. It's been such a fun conversation, but also very enlightening. And I think, you know, if you're a parent to be or just interested in this topic in general, it's really cool to be able to hear some of those highlights from the report and what to kind of keep an eye out for, where the trends have been, what are the potential reasons for the trends. It's all been very interesting, and I am without a doubt sure that the audience has very much been able to enjoy hearing you talk more extensively this time around as being the guest. So thank you for coming so prepared and sharing such fantastic insights with us. I know we all are leaving a lot better. So it's been a lot of fun, Ash. Thank you.
Thanks, Holly. It's been fun to be on the other side of the podcast host mic, and you've done a great job being a host. So thank you
too. Thanks, Ash. And if you'd like to see the full 2023 baby names report, just head to McCrindle.com and go to the resources section of the website. And to stay up to date with McCrindle's latest insights, you can simply subscribe to the podcast, follow us on social media, and head to McCrindle.com. And as Ash would say, and as I'm going to say today, as always, thank you for listening, and bye for now.